in the chat where you are tuning from. We love you. We can get started. Oh no, I turned it way up. I'm Megan. I am your field trips guide. If you need any technical support or have any questions, please feel free to message me and I will help you out as to the best of my abilities. If you are able to turn your camera even for a split second, we enjoy saying hello and getting a wave. We understand if you can't do that, not a problem. And I'm going to turn it over to Anne, who is all excited and ready to get started.
Oh, that was exciting. That was actually the song that I was playing to get pumped up for this right before starting. So some people got started sharing in the chat. I would love to hear where in the world you are joining from and what is your creative practice. I would encourage you to think really broadly and not put judgment on what you're calling a creative practice. This can be walking, it can be meditation, it can be singing or cooking or mindfulness. So let's just take a moment to think about what this is and share. So I'm going to share with you what my creative art practice is. I make charts and graphs and I share them with people as a way for me to process experiences in the world. And I keep them in a notebook like this. I wake up and I pour a cup of coffee and I process what's happening. This for me was influenced heavily by The Artist's Way. Yeah, I can see some people nodding out there. So this is a pretty familiar book in our community. In The Artist's Way, this book is nothing new. Julia Cameron talks about the importance of morning pages and taking time in the morning or whenever you have time in the day to get the garbage out on paper, to get the ideas and the chatter off your mind so that you can free yourself up for more creative thoughts. Okay, I'm gonna take a little peek at some of the things people are sharing. Oh, I love this. Dancing, aerial arts, motion design, sketching, painting. Wonderful. Yeah, and some people are saying that this book is on your reading list. That is wonderful. So you might feel bashful about calling whatever it is that you do on a regular basis a creative practice, but I think that that self-judgment can get in our way of really validating and creating that space for taking time to do this practice on a regular basis. In this way, we're thinking about using a daily practice to get away from being perfectionists and only doing things that are perfect. And we're actually creating more quantity. So in this way, quantity is greater than quality. I was recently reading Atomic Habits by James Clear. If you haven't read Atomic Habits yet, I would really encourage you to check out that book. He is all about creating systems for your healthy habits. So he shared a study of photography students that the group was broken into two different groups. And one half of the students submit a photo every single day. And at the end of the term, a bunch of master photographers judged the photos. And the best photos in the class came from the group that was creating work daily. So in this way, we're looking at, don't do things perfectly, do it regularly. So the format of our time together is going to roughly go as follows. We're going to start by looking at the barriers that are in place to us having focused time for our creative work. And then we're going to take just a quick moment to go into breakout rooms and discuss what those barriers are and how we can overcome them. Then we're going to reflect on our daily energy patterns. We're actually going to draw a little schedule of our day. And then we're going to create implementation intentions. It's okay if you haven't heard this language. And we're also going to share these really quickly. And then we're going to finish up the last 15 minutes or so. We're going to actually put this practice into our calendars. Okay, so our first activity. I'd like everyone, I hope you have a notepad on hand, to do a little simple T chart. And here, think about what are barriers. So these can be excuses that we make. Like for me, sometimes my phone is a barrier for me having productive work time, or maybe I'm sleepy or I'm hungry. Maybe you have legitimate barriers in your life. Like you actually have children to care for, or you have a day job. That's fine. Let's go ahead and list some of these barriers out. I'm going to share some of my examples just so you can kind of see a starting point. And let's take a minute to look at that. I'm going to check on our chat. Okay, so now that people have taken a moment to jot down a couple barriers, let's start thinking about what are some potential ways that you can overcome each of these barriers. So some potential solutions that I have listed here is like having an unstructured schedule. Because I work for myself, I actually had to create and follow a schedule. Or if Instagram is a distraction for you, then maybe you need to delete the app off of your phone and just use it on the desktop computer. So let's take about a minute here and jot down some potential solutions that you might be able to leverage here. Would anyone like to share what one of their barriers or potential solutions is in the chat? I would love to hear it. Ooh, yeah, okay. So guilt, I love that. Inner voice saying later. Yeah, getting up too late. Thinking about our grief. Absolutely. Yeah. No creative space. Imposter syndrome. Absolutely. Yeah. On one of mine, I listed, is this a good use of my time? I actually judge if my creative practice is even worthy of my time. But I think even just saying that out loud or writing it down, I realize how ridiculous that is. Yeah, it's not a good use of my time. Yep, waiting to be ready. Yeah. Okay, so in the next slide, I would like for us to health issues. Yeah. Not sure where to start. Yeah. You know what? All of these are completely legitimate. I mean, you don't need anyone to tell you that. So in the breakout rooms, we are going to go for 5 minutes into the breakout rooms with groups of about 5 people and share, each person in the group, share what one barrier is to doing your creative practice as well as you would like to, as frequently as you would like to, and then one potential solution with your group. And then we will rejoin back in here and we're going to keep moving with that exercise. Okay, awesome. I'm so glad that I got to be in a breakout room with folks and hear the sorts of barriers from people. So things like self-judgment, creating physical space when so many of us are working from home, that's a huge challenge. Needing to ask your family for that space and support for your practice, health issues, And one person proposed that maybe just putting it in the calendar and blocking that time for it was a potential solution. So thank you so much for sharing there. We'll go back to my PowerPoint. Okay, so we talked about our barriers and then we talked about our potential solutions. Now, how can we take it a step further and not just remove barriers, but make it fun to do our creative practice? So I wanted to show you guys a solution that I came up with. We're going to take a field trip within a field trip. I have an accordion that is sitting out right here on my coffee table, and it's not inside the box because for me, just getting it out of the box is a barrier. A friend shared yesterday that one of her solutions to exercising is to have running shoes by the door with clean socks in them already. So that's one way to make it a little bit easier. If it's, for me, like exercise is really challenging. Well, the motivation part is challenging, following through on it. But if I have it on my schedule and if it's social, then I'm excited to do it. So I would love to hear some tips from people or some ideas for how you can take your barriers, whether they're real or perceived, and not just remove your barriers, but make it really fun, make it sexy, make it exciting. Let's hear a couple things in the chat. So in the writing process, letting myself put funny things throughout the day into notes on my phone. Perfect, perfect. So on your list of barriers and potential solutions, I would love to see you circle the easiest and the potentially most impactful thing that you can take action on. So in that list, is there any one thing that you can look through and say, you know, this is going to be my homework assignment for today. I'm going to go out and purchase pens that I actually like to use. Or I'm going to create a playlist. Someone just put playlist on there. Awesome. I'm going to create a playlist that I'll use when I'm doing my practice. Okay, we're going to move right along. So it's great if chats still keep coming in, that's wonderful. So decision fatigue. I am curious, has anyone in this group heard about decision fatigue? Can you raise your hand? Yes, okay. Lots of people talking about decision fatigue. So decision fatigue is that psychological drain that we feel when we have to make continual decisions at every juncture throughout the day. So you wake up in the morning, oh, what are you going to wear? What are you going to make for breakfast? And meanwhile, this is exhausting your creative energy. Also, when you have those junctures between, should I take this time and sit down with my journal? Or wait, I have unscheduled time. I can just sit and look at my phone. I'm personally going to veer towards doing the easier task. I think we do have that tendency as people to, when we don't have plan time, we're going to fill it up with garbage. But if we already have a schedule in place for how we're using our time, we're more likely to choose the better option. It's already been decided for you. You have your art practice time scheduled into this time. I find that scheduling my exercise, I have it 2 gym appointments a week, and putting that in my calendar, there's no more time for deliberating. It's been decided. Our next exercise is we are actually going to draw our schedule for the week. Yours may look different than this if you work different days or different hours. In the end, your schedule for the week, we're going to fill in all these details that I've written along the right-hand column. So the first thing to do is to just draw out, what does your work week look like in general? This is not where you put your dentist's appointment. This is where you put the general patterns that you can count on over the course of a week. So each week I know that I have certain trainings that I need to facilitate on Thursday morning. So I'm going to block out that time. So block out your non-negotiable things in your calendar. And then next, you're going to block out your healthy habits. Why are we putting healthy habits so high up in here? I firmly believe in eating and exercise and moving your body. That is a fundamental structure. So a question coming in, what if your productive hours are at a time when you don't want them to be? Yeah, for example, I write fairly well at night, but I would prefer to do it earlier in the day. Yeah, brilliant. I don't know. I think maybe accepting that. Can you have these graphs later? Totally. As far as the productive hours, I had a partner who is a musician, and he would do a stint of focused hours from 10 p.m. to 2 a.m. And he found that that was a really productive window where he had no distractions because no one's really calling at those hours. So I think that inspired me to really think creatively of like, your productive hours aren't necessarily going to be in the morning. Maybe they will be late at night and you can just block those. And if you're going to have productive hours late at night, then think about having goof off hours in the middle of the day. So then the next thing I would do is identify foggy hours. So that's step four. So for me, I am very foggy in like the noon to 2 p.m. timeframe. After I've done a chunk of working first thing in the morning, that middle of the day time is not my sharpest work. That's not going to be my most creative work. And that will be a good time for either checking emails, which isn't very mentally taxing. It's not creative work, or maybe doing meetings. I actually find that meetings, because I'm an extrovert, are very stimulating. So I'll schedule my social meetings with colleagues during that time. Okay, so finally we're at step five, and I'm going to advance the slide so that you can see what this looks like for me. So I have put in big pink outlines peak focus hours. For my schedule, the 7 to 9 a.m. range on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, I know my boss will not be interrupting me. Family will not be interrupting me. These are times where I can count on having dedicated time, and I've scheduled it. I've put it into my schedule. These are my writing hours. And sometimes I even put my phone in the kitchen, plugged in during these times. I ought to do that more consistently. I also have a chunk on Thursday afternoon that I can count on. For whatever reason, this has worked with my schedule. Also, I think it's great I put Friday afternoon. I've learned over time that Fridays are mostly useless for me. And I work for myself, and I don't believe in 40-hour work weeks. So I put chillaxing time on Friday afternoon. And you know, I don't feel guilty about it. When Friday rolls around and I see in my schedule, I have allowed myself time and space for goofing off. I feel awesome about it. And I really hope that everyone has time to completely goof off built into their schedules. Okay, so we had a question, and I realized I didn't define proactive versus reactive work. So reactive work, which I have scheduled at about noon on Wednesday and Thursday, reactive work, it is not very taxing mentally or creatively. Reactive is when you are responding, you are reacting to other people's requests. And proactive work is what we want to be focusing on the most. Proactive is when you are advancing your own goals, when you are working and creating some really thoughtfully embedded into our schedules daily. And my proactive work time is that pink time. So that proactive time is for you to be thoughtfully innovating and protect that at all costs. Yeah, and then a comment of sticking to the schedule is willpower. Hopefully over time, it moves away from being willpower and it turns into being a habit, and it will actually decrease willpower. Initially, while you get in the habit of it and when you set up your systems, it may take willpower. What do you do when your schedule is constantly shifting? How do you create order in the middle of that? Oh man, wish I knew. Let me know when you find the answer there. That is really challenging. Okay, so we have a bit more time here. You can continue to work on this, but we're going to go into smaller breakout rooms and discuss some of these patterns in your day. And if you don't have time to draw this full calendar, that is fine. Just prioritize thinking about when in your week could you prioritize creative focus time that you can protect and make it just as sacred as your working times, or just as sacred as appointment viewing TV shows. So let's, Megan, go into breakout rooms again. I felt like the last breakout rooms were pretty fast. So let's do 8 minutes on this time. Okay, welcome back. I want to talk for a second about habit stacking. Has anyone in this group heard of habit stacking? Can I get anyone? Yeah, okay, we got some hands raised. So habit stacking is where you take a habit that you're already doing effectively. So for me, I am a great coffee drinker. I make coffee every morning without fail. While I am making my coffee, I simply do in addition is an opportunity for you to look at a habit that you already have built into your schedule and then just add a step to it. Maybe after a person mentioned after walking the dog, then they do their sit down and write creatively time. This next section, we are talking about implementation intentions. I learned about implementation intentions really recently when reading Atomic Habits. And if we could drop into the chat, Megan, Atomic Habits by James Clear. This is a fantastic book about habits in general. So implementation intentions are the premise that the more clear we are about exactly what practice we are doing and when we're doing it and how we're doing it, the greater our likelihood of success is executing on that habit. So many research studies have been done on implementation in intentions. In this research study, the participants were divided into three. The second group of people was asked to write a reflection after they did their habit to keep track of how well they did. The third group was asked to create an implementation intention defining how and when and where they will do their habit. An interesting thing about this one that I learned recently is that people who do phone banking for voting. So leading up to the elections, do you get those phone calls about, oh, you know, we see you're registered, do you plan to vote? So when research was done on who actually voted, people that asked more specific questions from people on the line about how are you going to get to the polls? What bus are you going to take? What day are you going? Are you going with somebody? The more concretely they committed, the more success they had on following through on that commitment. So we've gotten to this point in our program together where we've talked about some barriers. We've hopefully identified some times in our schedule where we have some openness to create some structure. Now we're going to make an implementation intention, a commitment to ourselves. We're going to put it down on paper. We're going to get really crystal clear about what we're doing. So a little bit more on implementation intentions. Instead of having a vague goal, this is where we're going to create our concrete plan. So for me, I will pull out my journal on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday at 8 a.m. and write, draw while drinking my coffee. Now, I did not put a time constraint on this. I didn't say I'll do it for an hour because, to be honest with you, I can't necessarily commit to an hour. And I would rather do it regularly than do it perfectly. Here is our template for creating an implementation intention. I will do blank action at blank time in blank location. You are welcome to get even more specific on this if you would like. So I'm going to allow a few minutes for us to just sit and write here. So there are a couple questions that I would love to address. One of them is, what if your focus time is during your day job and your schedule is constantly shifting? I would encourage you to at least try to talk to your manager about this. And also, you might need to really believe in the value of your creative practice and tell your boss how important it is to you. I have a hard time imagining many managers who wouldn't respect that. Maybe I'm delusional, but I feel like if I went to my boss and said, I really need to have this protected time in my schedule, can we block this time? At least start the negotiations there. I would love to believe that they would respect that. Okay, so for the sake of time, I wonder if people could share their implementation intentions in the chat. Also, this will give you an opportunity to write them down. You're putting it out there for the universe. You're committing to everybody out there. And then also just save that note. Maybe you copy and paste it and you keep it as a note in your phone. Or where would you place this implementation intention where you can follow through with it? I will do my morning art pages when I wake up in bed. Perfect. I will write every weekday at 2 p.m. Ah, I love this. I will draw and paint at 8 a.m. at my desk. These are wonderful. I will shoot, edit at 7 a.m. in the living room table. Beautiful. I will capture ideas in my notebook when having my morning coffee. I will play my ukulele at 3 p.m. in my living room. Yeah, I will practice drawing every workday at 10 a.m. in my dining room. These are awesome. So in the same way that we created that if Y, then X for our implementation intentions, we can think about using these implementation intentions to overcome the barriers that we know are going to come our way. So if I get distracted by my cell phone, then I will put it in the kitchen. Or what's another one? If I get sleepy, then I will take a walk or I'll take a nap. So you can use these implementation intentions to make a plan so that you don't have to fight decision fatigue at all these junctures. Okay, this is our last thing that we have to do. We have our plan. We know when our productive windows are. Now, I want you to actually block this time in every calendar you own. I'm going to show you that I actually have this blocked into my calendar. So you'll see in my calendar, I have that line for 8 to 9 a.m. writing time. And this is on every day. I wanted everyone to have my information if you would like to follow up, if you would like to chat more about this. I think I'm the most accessible Ann Parmeter on the internet, annparmeter.com. I'm at Ann Parmeter on Instagram. And yeah, I mean, you could probably just walk out on the street and yell Ann Parmeter and maybe I would be there. So a couple opportunities that Megan dropped into the chat are my Instagram account. And another thing, I lead weekly workshops on productivity for entrepreneurs for a free software application called Focus. So I put a link for that. If you would like to join in those productivity workshops, I would love to see you there. And the final thing, was that it? Oh, I have a time management course out there on the internet as well. And I love people are putting their Instagram handles in here as well. So I would love for people to connect on here and to talk about their accountability practices. I'm happy to share these slides with anyone if you would like them. I created them just with watercolors and then I took pictures of the watercolors. I find it to be a little bit more fun than looking at a boring PowerPoint. At this point, if anyone has questions, if you want to just like hang out and chat for the next couple minutes, please do. I wish I had answers for all of this work. I don't want anyone to think that this comes easily. Time management, it's not easy. Making space for a creative practice is so challenging for me, at least. So I don't have the answers for it at all. I'm struggling with everyone else out there. So this is just stuff that's worked for me. And it's great to see some familiar faces in here.
Well, while we wait to see if there's any questions, I'll remind everyone that they can save the chat if they want to review any of the resources or capture any of those social media handles. Somebody had asked me to collect books mentioned, and I grabbed two that you mentioned, Anne, The Artist's Way by Julia Cameron and Atomic Habits by James Clear. So I'll put those in the chat as well. To save the chat, it's those three little dots right above your chat input box. And I don't believe it works on mobile Zoom, or it didn't used to, but if you're on a desktop, you should be able to save it there.
Oh, that's incredible.
Mm-hmm. All right, and I'll give everyone a chance to unmute so they can say goodbye and thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you so much.
Bye.
Keep shining.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have fun.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.